Hello, everyone. Welcome to our Coming Out Stories from India series. Coming out, what is it? Coming out is a term used primarily in the LGBT community when a queer person shares about their sexual orientation, usually with friends and family. Nicola and I decided to launch these Coming Out Stories from India to ensure all of us work together in changing the narrative. We aim to give the next generation positive role models, positive stories, and information that can help them make the right choices. I'm Raga D'silva, or Totally Out Now, as you know me. Our guest today actually needs no introduction in the international LGBT space. A well-known filmmaker in the queer space, he's the co-founder of Kashish Mumbai International Film Festival, amongst many, many, many other things. Please join me in welcoming Sridhar Rangayan.
Hi, nice to be here, Raga. Really appreciate having me on your show.
Yeah, Sridhar, I absolutely love having you. I remember meeting you for the first time at a Kashish, your film festival. And I told Nicola, this man is like the most amazing person I've met because you're so friendly. And you remember this conversation?
That's also a problem because I'm too accessible. So I need to cut down on that.
Oh, so next time you see us, you'll still say hi to us, I hope.
Of course.
You remember the Milind Soman conversation we had, Sridhar? You may remember.
No, not really.
So next time we have coffee together, we should remember, we talk about that. But you know, Sridhar, thank you, first of all. Really, I thank you for having this interaction with us. It's very important because I think we need to speak to veterans, as we call people like us in the community, to share their stories, because people haven't really realized that all of us have actually been through a journey. We have been through a long journey because of which the community today is able to express themselves the way they do. And one big example is the movie we watched last night that was written by you, directed by you, produced by you, called Evening Shadows. I want to start with that, Sridhar. So, because to me, is it autobiographical, first of all?
It's I would say semi-autobiographical. It's based on certain life experiences of myself, but also integrates many life experiences of many gay men, and also my partner Sagar Gupta, who is a co-writer of the film. So his experiences with mother, many other gay men's experiences with his mothers, and also we have incorporated parents whom we have, I know, out parents per se, parents of gay children. So their experiences, it's a kind of, I would say, it is semi-autobiographical, but also we want to make it universal. So we have integrated many stories into one. So a lot of things which you see, obviously my father was not that cruel. So I was a bit traumatized per se. But yeah, many parts of my mother is in Vasudha in the film Evening Shadows. Yeah.
So did you have that kind of a relationship with your mother? Do you have that?
Yeah, I mean, I've had a fantastically close relationship with my mother, though I've been living and staying outside my home for many, many years. I moved out of home when I was like, when I started studying for the 11th standard, which means like I was like, 17 or something like that, you know. I moved out of my home to study in hostels and colleges, and have not been at home for a long time since then, you know. But I feel really close to my mother, and basically when I was growing up and with my mother, I used to be always in the kitchen with her talking. I'm not cooking per se. She would never allow me to touch anything per se, coming from a very typical Tamilian Brahminical family in a small town. I'm from a what's called Tam Bram, which means a Tamilian Brahmin. So I supposed to belong to the upper class, which I don't like that word per se, but unfortunately I'm born into that and that's the way it is. So when I was growing up, I was like, it was in a small town near Mysore, and there was absolutely like a very typical upbringing, which is in a conservative family. So my parents, we lived in a large family with a lot of my aunts and uncles staying with us, you know, in our own home. So it was kind of a very large extended family staying in one house. So we didn't have privacy per se. we didn't have our moments with each other. So the only moment I would get with my mother was when she was cooking in the kitchen. So I would actually be stationed in the kitchen talking to her when she was cooking. And of course, I think I learned a lot from her cooking tips, and I'm a fairly reasonably cook now, fairly reasonably well, a good cook. But basically the thing is like that, one of my uncle had made a song which says that like Sridhar is always catching the pallu of mother's sari and roaming around her. You know, pallu is the sari, that thing. And basically, so he's always attached to his mother's pallu. So that's the way I was. I would share everything with her, and she would share a lot with me, which she never shared with anybody else, because as a housewife in a small town, in a conservative family, a large extended family, she had her own set of problems. I mean, with her in-laws and stuff like that. So she would actually share a lot with me. She has never shared so many details with anybody else. Whenever we would go out of town on a bus or something, we would have these long talks with each other. And of course, she would cry. She's a crybaby. Unfortunately, my mother, she's also a beautiful person, but she also cries a lot at the drop of a hat. But basically, the thing is, myself and my mother had these beautiful conversations, which I think kind of enabled me to understand what the socio-cultural milieu she existed in, you know, and that translates to the character of Vasudha in the film Evening Shadows, if I just may say so. And the beauty of it was like Evening Shadows was shot, I think, around like 10 kilometers from my own hometown. So it's very typical. My hometown is in Mandya, and we shot it in Srirangpatna, which is around 10 kilometers away. So it's kind of very genuine milieu from where I grew. But as I said, we have amalgamated a lot of other experiences to make it more universal.
Hey, I'm going to digress. Thank you for that. Is that where the big stones are, large stones are? Srirangpatnam? Is that when you go?
No, that is basically Ramnagaram, which is the closer to Bangalore, where film Sholay was shot. You know, this is like closer to Mysore per se.
So your mom and you, like, let's say, are very close, very, you know, attached to each other, share everything. So did you feel the pressure of being the son to your mother at any point when you were growing? I'm talking about your growing up days. Was there pressure on you as a man?
No, I don't think so. I mean, I was, I always still look upon myself as a young child of my mother. So I didn't feel the pressure of being a man. Even now, I don't feel like a man. I still feel like a young child who's just growing up and opening his eyes yet. So that was never the thing. But if there was an issue with my mother and my father, I would not go in between. I mean, I'm saying like I would not ever step in between their problems, and her problem was her own problem, my father's problem was other. So I pretty much, and as I said, like I stepped out of my home when I was almost 16 or 17 years old, and I've been growing up outside my hometown. So my visits, only when I go back for a month or something, I would be with them, and that's the only interaction I had, of course. And earlier days, I grew up in a, I was born in 1962. So I grew up in an age when there was no phone, mobile phones, there was no telephones which I had access to. So we would write letters to each other. So I still have a lot of my letters written by my mother, which is beautiful. You know, I preserved that. And so she also had preserved my letters to her, and she gave back all my letters, which I had written to her. So it's a beautiful collection of personal letters from each other. Yeah.
How beautiful. So during that time, there were, you know, we're talking about this aerogram days, right? That's what we're talking about. Inland letters, they were called. I remember them as well. You know, by the time you received them, the child they were talking about had become 6 years old. You know, typically, that's what I would say. So anyway, so during this time, was that when you, I'm assuming that you went through a discovery process somewhere around that time of your self-discovery process. What was the kind of scene in India, of the LGBT scene in India, in your growing up days?
So, I mean, I'm talking about like 1970s, late 70s, when I was really in my teens and all. I was totally uncomfortable with the way I was feeling from within. Basically, what is the attraction? The attraction at that point of time is to a boy in the school. And you would never, ever actualize it, because at that point of time, there was no conscious understanding of what being gay was at all. I mean, it was not in the dictionary anyway. The only word which was homosexual was in the medical dictionary, you know, that's the only way. But even that I didn't know, I mean, at all, you know. The only interaction would be school classmates whom I would have a crush on, but would never dare say anything. But there were, of course, a kind of a nighttime dalliances with my uncle and my cousins, you know, which was never spoken about. It was basically a sexual encounter in the dark, in the night. Then it was never spoken about ever again, you know, with my cousins and my uncle. So that has been, and I would actually always feel horrible after that next day, you know, what did I do this? I mean, of course, it was very, it was not really going the full hog. It was basically kissing and cuddling and mutual masturbation of each other. That's all it stopped at, you know, it didn't go any further. But still, I would feel really horrible the next day. What did I go through this? And why am I feeling like this kind of a, I wouldn't even call attraction. There was this sexual energy with that other person in the night. And I would really feel horrible. And I still remember that like the whole attraction to a person existed even then, but I never actualized it. And even I didn't even speak, I was a very late bloomer. So I came out only in 1989, which was like I was 26 years old. You know, that late, you know. So I'll come to that later, but never ever spoken about it right through my college days when I was staying in a hostel in Udupi, which is a small town in near Mangalore. And even then, I had sexual dalliances with my hostel mates. But again, it was all in the dark, never spoken about, felt extremely guilty. And even when I was studying in Suratkal, I did my engineering from Suratkal College, and 5 years there in a hostel full of only men. Now, there were no women. Usually engineering, we just had in my class, I think two women in my entire class. So that's the kind of this one. And everybody would not speak about it ever, you know. And there's only one friend in my engineering college days for whom I felt, I would say, romantic feeling for, but it was never expressed. I think he also had a romantic feeling for me, but we never expressed it. We acted out as very, very good friends per se, and that's the way it went. But at the same time, I was also in love with a girl. So I mean, technically, basically, there was this a girl when I was in my hometown, and we basically considered ourselves girlfriend boyfriends, you know. And then when I went off to the hostel, we started writing letters to each other, sending those cutie gifts and stuff like that, you know, Archie's cards and stuff like that. So that continued for almost like 3-4 years. Whenever I went back home, we would meet up secretly that time, because even meeting a girl was supposed to be secret, not meeting a boy. So we would meet secretly and then basically go out on for a coffee or something. And then once I think we went for a movie together, you know, myself and this girlfriend, and she held my hand, you know, at that point. That's the first physical touch of a girl whom I supposed to be dating, you know, and that really scared me. And something in me kind of didn't feel right. I didn't know anything about that I was gay or homosexual at that time. But I just told her, I think 3 days later, through a letter saying that, like, I think we need to break up this, whatever this relationship is, because I don't think I can carry on. That's all I said, you know. So then later, much later, almost like after 7-8 years, I met her again. And she said, why did you break off that point of time? So I told her that, like, because I realized that I was gay much later, but I didn't feel right at that point of time. So she said, like, oh, even if I had known that you're gay, I would have still wanted to be your girlfriend and marry you, because you're such a sensitive human being, and I would have liked to have a husband like you. But I said, no, don't ever get into that space, because marrying a gay man is just not a good idea at all for the woman. The man can just go ahead and have other dalliances with other men in the dark, but the woman is a person who's going to be suffering as a wife of a gay man. And in India right now, there's no support system at all for wife of gay men, and that's something I'm really concerned about. We can talk about that later, but yeah, that's my experience per se. Yeah.
So Sridhar, so you've dated this woman, you've discovered that that's not what you want. But you were emotionally attracted to a woman. Right. So it's not that you were not emotionally attracted to her, you know, which is
Everybody was having a girlfriend at that time. So even I wanted to have a girlfriend, and I was definitely emotionally invested in that girl. I was like, it was just a blank letter writing kind of thing. I wrote beautiful letters to her for sure. But I think, I would say that. And also, like, I mean, I would say that, like, even because we are so inculcated with the dominant heterosexual portrayal in Hindi cinema. So I fell in love with Rekha with her long hair. I mean, I'm still in love with Rekha, you know, but right now, not as I would say romantically still like Rekha, you know, but not really sexually like Rekha, you know. Yeah. That differentiation I understood much later. Yeah.
Sure. So there's so many stereotypes and myths around that, right? So I'm glad that we're exploring this aspect as well. So Sridhar, so at what point between this last date that you had, or the first date where she held your hand and you felt that physical touch, I don't feel anything for this woman. So did you decide that between this that you actually were attracted to men? And what was that jump? What was that one point, was it? Or was it a series?
No,
or?
I don't think I even discovered that. I knew that I was sexually having these alliances with men, which I was extremely ashamed of till many, many years. But I just felt I don't want to continue this particular relationship with this girl, because I feel that like she should have somebody who is worthy of her. That's the way I felt at that point of time, you know. Though she considered me worthy, but I felt like she should go ahead and date somebody who is worthy of her. And that's the reason I broke up. But at that point of time, I never even considered that I'm this whole... The word gay didn't exist. You can't believe it today when we're talking about it. But in the 1980s, there was no word like that. You know, nobody spoke about that. Only late 1990, the word started popping up, because Bombay Dose, one of the magazine we're going to talk about later. And that really brought out the mainstream, the word gay. But otherwise, the only thing I would say, as I said, like medical dictionary, the word homosexual, I would look up because I heard somewhere. And I would actually be looking at the penis in the medical anatomy books, because that was exciting, because there's no porn at all. There's no printed porn. There's no visual porn ever. Nowadays, you can just go on a mobile phone and see porn, or go on YouTube and see porn. But that time, there's nothing. So you had no idea of any kind of... So it's nothing to do with the gay experiences. There was no sexual experiences which are visible. I mean, the Bollywood basically subsumed all sexual experiences. They just portrayed this love and family drama, etc. The sexual... I would say it's like a very, very slow coming out process for me. And it's taken too long. I don't know. Yeah.
Did you fall in love eventually?
I fell in love... I fell in love with a guy only in 1991 or something like that, you know. Okay, 1990, when I came out on the scene. I basically start in 1989 was my turning point per se, when the first copy of Bombay Dose was published. And my classmate from IIT Bombay, so from NITK Suratkal, I shifted to IIT Bombay to do my master's for 2 years. And that's when I met Suhail Abbas. He was my classmate at IIT Bombay. And he basically, we both were great friends for 2 years, or after that, 2 more years. But we never spoke about both of us being gay, you know, at all. We just was negotiating that space without even ever speaking about it. And basically, he finally came out and joined the team of Bombay Dose. He co-founded Bombay Dose along with Ashok Rav Kavi, you know. And the first issue of the magazine was given to me when I was doing a film appreciation course in Pune. And I just said, what is this nonsense? How can you just talk about something which you feel so deep inside publicly on a magazine, you know? So I kind of rejected the entire idea, but I took the magazine and into the room, and in the night I read from page 1 to page 20, you know, and something changed in me at that point of time. I mean, that is like one, I would say, dark night in FTI Pune. And so I realized that my personal has to be political, you know. So then I basically offered to Suhail Abbasi, saying that, like, I would like to be associated with designing the magazine. I didn't still come out to him that is I'm gay, you know. So that then he of course realized that I'm gay. Then he started taking me to gay parties, you know. I mean, like friends parties, friends who are gay and stuff like that. And for 2 years, I actually pretended that I'm still straight friend of this gay man. And I went to these parties. I went to also Gokul's, which was like the hangout of gay men near Gateway of India in Mumbai, you know. And that was like supposed to be a gay hangout every Saturday. And I would go there and would still pretend to be straight. And I would go to some of these parties and kiss people in the corner without anybody knowing. But everybody knew. Everybody knew. Only I was not accepting it. So I think only in 1991, I finally told myself, and I told my friend, the same Suhail Abbasi, and it was a kind of a lockdown day, because there was a band. You know what's a band? When people protest about something and ask the entire city to be shut down, you know? So it was a band day, and myself and Suhail were at my home. And I came out to him at that point of time that I'm gay. And he said, I knew it for the last 5 years. What are you talking about now? But at that point of time, I just want to mention that, like, I did fall in love with a guy, a very well-known playwright and a screenplay writer. I will not name that person, of course. But I fell in love, and madly in love. And for 1 year, so I met him on New Year, one of the New Year Eve parties somewhere in Bangalore. And then I fell in love with him and we exchanged a couple of letters those days, you know, we just kind of broke up because a long distance relationship didn't work out. And that was one person I truly was in love with till I met Sagar, who is my love of my life right now. That is in 1994. So we'll come to that. But yeah, I mean, I was really in love with this person who I just felt didn't reciprocate enough my love to him, you know. And that basically left me a bit shattered. But at that point of time, I was young and I was like having this like right of my life, discovering my sexuality, doing Bombedos work and being the part of this large extended gay family, which we are just putting together at that time. And having, of course, cruising in the night and everywhere and like having sex. So it was quite that time, I would say 1989 to 1994, which was my liberation time. And then Sagar came and I shut down.
No, I think you opened the doors to someone else, right? So, but Sridhar, why did it? I heard when you're saying these things, what I hear is that for a long time, it took you a long time to accept yourself. And I'm just trying to understand, why did you take that long? Was it fear of society or not understanding what it meant for you? Or was it just simply being in denial?
No, basically, I as I said, there was no information about being gay or homosexual till I didn't even open my eyes till the Bombedos article, the magazine came out. I'm sure there was bits and pieces in the media and there was no internet at that point of time, of course. So we couldn't even access world news at that point of time. So I had no idea what it meant to be interaction I'm having with somebody that can go anywhere. And of course, the whole idea of it being a sin, it being a perversion, handed down by family moralities and social morality, that really hangs a lot. And you're supposed to, as your Indian Hindu boy, it's your karma to get married to a woman, you know, and produce a child who will light your funeral pyre when you die. I mean, that's supposed to be the karma which is supposed to be there. So all of us are supposed to marry a woman and have children so that that person can light a pyre and send you to heaven. And here was this whole thing when you don't know. I mean, you're not attracted to a woman. You are attracted to a man, but can't do anything about it, not even speak about it in the open. So it was a very, very tough time. And I've anguished myself a lot. I got my diaries filled with pages where I would write about my these feelings, but I would actually scratch it out. Because I don't want even anybody to read the diary and discover me. So, I mean, I have these diary pages, which is like all written in code language or scratched out lettering. And it's very traumatic time. And I would really, thankfully, I was like a bit more stronger and I never considered suicide as an option. I wanted to live. I was very happy with my life. I was like good at my college. I was good at my painting and those kind of things. I was good at my debates and elocutions. I was really good guy in that sense. But this whole nagging feeling that I'm doing something wrong, this physical need of mine is wrong, continue for, as I said, till I opened the magazine Bombedos, which is like my watershed time. So I think it's the sin and the idea of morality which is handed down to all of us, and especially Brahminical societies and from small town where there's absolutely no information about sexual orientation, sexuality per se. Even women's sexuality is not recognized there, you know. Women cannot supposed to have an orgasm at all, you know. Women are just supposed to just produce children without even knowing how it came from. So that's the way it is right till now. And so that's why I think it took a long time. But once I realized that this is who I am, I mean, it's not like, I mean, I always say that, okay, you look up in the mirror and look at the mirror and look at yourself and say you're gay. I never did that, of course. But basically, reading that magazine Bombedos, and I think it's like a switch which turns on and saying that, like, okay, this is who you are. And there's no really particular moment, but that's the way you feel from within that, like, this is what I'm going to be. But I didn't expect my life to take such a drastic turn that I'm going to be in the center of LGBTQ activism or movement. That is something I never visualized at all, never wanted to. I mean, it's just like one day I was like one of these quiet shy guys having quiet sex with the guys and not realizing who I was. And then the next day, almost the next year, I'm totally out in the open and doing this quote unquote activism work, which is totally bizarre for me. Yeah.
Well, I mean, thank the universe that you found you, because then it helped us, obviously. You know, but interesting, you know, did that put pressure on you? I'm coming back to that question again, because you talk about being tamper-proofed, coming from an extended conservative family. You can discover yourself. Now we're talking about those times, because I've been through this whole journey that you're talking about. So when you discovered yourself and you've accepted yourself now, and you go back to your family and you say to your mother, you know what, this is who I am. Now, did you come out to your mother, or did you... She just assumed and accepted, or was there pressure for you to marry, saying, forget it, just get married anyway?
So basically the thing is, even when I was not out to myself, I was basically, there was a lot of pressure for me to get married, though I was not that a marriageable age group, but there was already pressure building up. So I did see a couple of girls, you know, I mean, and I just felt so unright about the whole thing, that it's just not right when you see a girl and you don't want to marry her, and she goes back not knowing what it is, or knowing that she's kind of rejected, you know, kind of thing. So that really left. I mean, I just think I saw two girls, and one of the girls, I just kind of left it at that. But second girl, I basically wrote a letter to her saying that I'm really sorry. It's not your fault that, like, I'm not marrying you. It's just me per se. But I didn't write what I was. But I did see two girls, and of course, I said no. But the reason, there was no reason for me to say no. It was very difficult to tell my father why I'm not agreeing to marriage, telling my aunts and uncles and the entire extended family why I'm not getting married. So the only way you would say that, okay, I want to become a self-sufficient, I want to stand up on my feet, and I want to basically, and one of the things I was always keen on at that point of time was, like, I want to go abroad to study. I mean, I had migrated from a small town to Mumbai, which was my a gay Mecca, so to say, you know, so wherever I was opening up. But I always dreamt of going abroad, because I felt at that point of time, I didn't even realize that supposed to be my gay liberation, but I just felt that, like, I can live my life more openly out there. Okay, so I did apply quite a few times to go outside India. I got a college admission, a scholarship, but my visa got rejected 3 times, and that's a sad thing. Now looking back, it's a good thing that I couldn't go. But so there was a lot of pressure from my family to get married, for sure. They kept asking why I would not have an answer, because I didn't even accept myself. So then after that, like, I mean, 1989, I kind of came to know myself, and then 1995, I came out to my mother. It was pretty much like a late evening, like in the film Evening Shadows. Dusk was falling, but it was not in a boat, thankfully. So it wasn't. It was at my home, basically.
She didn't fall.
Yeah. So when nobody was there at home, and only my mother was there, and I told her that, like, and you know what? Like, there's no word in Tamil or Kannada, the language I speak with my mother, for this word gay at all. Okay, in Hindi, there's a samalaingik, which is, like, not what you are. That's supposed to be homosexual, you know? Mm-hmm. So the whole word gay doesn't exist in Indian languages, I mean, most of the Indian language. So I had to explain that, like, I don't like girls. I cannot get married. I like a man, and that man is Sagar. By then, I'd met Sagar. 1994, I'd met Sagar. So 1995, I came out to her and said, and that's how I told her. I mean, I took it that way. My route was that, saying that here is this person whom I love a lot, and we both want to live a life together, at the same way as in Evening Shadows, the way it goes. So we both want to live a life together as we grow older, you know. And so that was something a little bit more acceptable to her, but she didn't accept it at all. She kind of, the evening fell, the darkness happened. I couldn't see her tears, but I could hear her crying. I didn't reach out to her because I didn't know what to do. Then, of course, my father came home, and then light was on, and everything, we just kind of moved on. But we took almost, like, I would say 7-8 years before she reconciled. It was a very long journey, believe me, because she's from a small town, totally not have any knowledge about gay or homosexuality, or not even sexuality, as I said, but, you know. So she felt it was really wrong. And of course, I mean, the whole process that she felt she was to be blamed for not raising me right, you know. She didn't give me enough time. She pushed me into the hostel where I grew up most of the time. So those were the thoughts. And she said, like, okay, because your hostel life corrupted you, and then Bombay corrupted you, you know, Bombay, then Mumbai now. Bombay corrupted you, and your friends there corrupted you. I should have held a tighter leash. I should have had you at home. You should have been under my nigrani, I mean, vision, you know. So she blamed herself, and like also like, I mean, in the way in the Evening Shadows film, basically she blamed her gods for not listening to her, you know, I mean, and listening more to me. So she said, all your wishes are fulfilled. Why are my wishes not fulfilled of you getting married, etc.? So she, it was very tough, and we almost had not, we had actually broken contact for almost like 2 years, where there was no letters exchange, no phone calls. She didn't come to my home. Earlier, she would come to Bombay for her vacations. Like she would spend a month here in Bombay. But after I came out for, I think like 2 years, she didn't even come to Bombay. None of the family members came to Bombay. It was a very dark period. But I would go back, whenever I go back to my hometown, I would have these conversations. You know, I would push the button to have a conversation. I'm not radically, I'm not thrusting it into her face, but something or the other would come up. When the talk about Sagar would come up, I would bring in about the whole gay life, etc. And yeah, so it was like really tough, and for her per se to understand. And but she came around after almost like 6-7 years of conversations. And then, of course, I think she told my father, but I never know till now, because my father passed away without acknowledging the fact that like I was gay. Though he spoke once that it's going to be, I think it's a passing phase, hostel, in hostels, it happens like that. You should get married. But then after that, he also stopped asking me to get married. So everybody, and of course, after that, like, I mean, I also went through the whole bad feeling of going to a psychiatrist, you know, one of my family members told my mother that you should visit a psychiatrist. So my mother took me as a last resort to a psychiatrist. And so he showed this Rochas blot test, you know, so where you kind of show pictures and stuff like that. So I don't know what he told my the person who took me or my mother, but finally it kind of said that like you can't change him kind of thing. And she kept saying, even now she changed. I mean, I think over the last 5 years she stopped it, but even then she would say that like you can change, you just get married to a woman, everything will be okay, you know, that kind of thing. So that's the something which for parents will be always the last hope, that your son will get married, you know. So it's going to be tough for them. I know that, like, I mean, I've met a lot of parents who are struggling with the child sexuality, whether gay or lesbian or transgender. For transgender parents, it's much more difficult, because for them, they have to accept the change, complete change from the binary of the gender. And that's going to be really complicated. So I know that parents struggle in India, because I think lack of information, primarily, lack of resources to know more about it, you know. Where do they go? In their own language, in Tamil, there's hardly any books or anything. But I think over the years, she has managed to read articles slowly, whatever comes in her newspapers or magazines. She has managed to kind of get an idea and watches news and understands a bit of it. And our long conversations, of course, now sometimes, of course, the conversation get really weird. What do you do in bed? So I don't, I said, Bob, you don't have to know.
Anyway. Oh, yeah, I'm sure that happened. But, you know, I'm just, when I'm listening to you, I'm thinking about my own life as well. You know, my mother got to know that, you know, I was interested in women. And this was after marriage, after having children. And she took it really badly. Like, she wanted to kill me. She basically held a knife over me. She said, this is it. You're going to cause scandal to the family. And, but, you know, I've always felt that unconditional love comes from a mother mostly, right? More than the parents per se, it's the mother. And I just want to ask you, because, you know, it seems now you have a fairy tale life, like I seem to have a fairy tale life, but, you know, people don't realize that time that you've been through, which has been really inside you. And I'm assuming you didn't have friends that you could speak with as well, because you wrote diary in your diary. So how did it make you feel? What if your mother had not relented? Would you have said to her that, okay, I'll marry to keep her happy? How did it feel for you right inside?
I still feel very guilty even today. I mean, though I'm settled and happy and out and proud and all that, but I still feel guilty that like I could not make my mother happy. I mean, I know that like this is not the only happiness that she needs, you know, but that whole idea that like she feels more happy, she had that she saw me married and have a child, a grandchild, etc., you know. And also, I think I did, I mean, during her coming to terms with herself phase, right now she's out of it, you know. But during that time, I just felt really miserable. I just said, why am I even alive and hurt, causing so much of hurt to the person whom I so much love, you know. I mean, that's one person I love the most in the world, you know, my mother. And I'm causing her so much of pain and agony, you know, because every time I would call her on the phone, she would start crying, you know, and her letters were kind of, I would say, not dipped in tears, but kind of dipped in tears, you know, I mean, her language was kind of that. So I just felt like, what am I doing? But I never considered, once I came out to myself in 1989, I never considered marriage as an option, never. That's something which was ruled out for me. Totally, because I just felt this is who I am and I have to stand by who I am. And I mean, the whole politics of the wife of a gay man, politics didn't enter at that point of time, but I just felt it was not right for me to get married to a woman. But never considered marriage, even for placating my mother or basically offering a solution to her grief. But I would say, let's talk about it. Let's try to kind of arrive at an understanding for you, you know. I mean, that's like really been a very, very tough journey, and it still feels really bad. And a lot of people say that, like, okay, if you were born in the next life, you know, what would you prefer? And some people say, I would love to be born as a gay man. I said, no, I mean, I don't want to be born as a gay man. I'm talking about 1962 to 1990 and 2000, you know, the phase I went through. I mean, I don't want to be born as a gay man because it caused so much of hurt to myself and hurt to my parents. But this is just one aspect of it. But the hurt is also about the whole blackmail and harassment one went through as a gay man, being underground. I'm talking about the early phases. Right now, it's all okay. Everybody's like very happy. But the police were there, the blackmailers were there, the hustlers were there. And you are always in fear. And also the in between, there's this whole right-wing government which is in Mumbai, you know, which is was anti-gay per se. So you're really scared all the time. And I've lived with this fear for many, many years. You know, I would date somebody, bring that person home, and that person would turn around and ask me for money, break a beer bottle and show it at me and extract money. I mean, I've had gone through all this, you know. Okay. So, and people coming to my home, pretending that they want to have sex and then steal a VCR or a cassette player recorder and go away. And I can't do anything about it. I'm just watching this person walk away with my material, and I can't scream because the neighbor will know. And I mean, these are the really horrible moments, and you don't know who will turn. I mean, who will turn against you? Think that person is okay when you kind of met that person. But also, I think a lot of gay men cruised and found danger. I mean, we cruise danger. I mean, unfortunately, that's the way it is. Because there was, at that point of time, there was no dating apps. How would you find a person? How would you find another gay man to have sex with? The only way is you cruise in the streets, you know? You cruise the person, then pick up that person, bring them home, and that person can be anybody. He could be a murderer, he could be a blackmailer, you don't know. So one has gone through all that. One has been caught by the police. One has gone through, I don't want to talk about it much, but these are scars which will never go away. So I come from a generation who's totally scarred about their sexuality, and that can never be healed. I mean, that's the sad part, you know. Even now, I would say, even today, if I mean, not that I want to bring anybody home, but if I were to bring anybody home, I'd be super scared because they could do anything, you know. I mean, that's whole scars in the past never heal. And I just feel that, like, I wish I didn't have to go through that whole phase. I mean, so I know that today's youngsters do have more challenges than in the past. You know, they have newer challenges. They don't have this challenge of being underground, invisible, stigmatized, violated, you know. I'm sure they have more challenges. But I think our generation was really gone through a lot, per se. And I still know that a lot of people crumbled to it. I mean, a lot of people got married, living double life. And that is more crazy because they're not happy either way. At least I managed to stand up and I'm happy. I'm doing what I want to do, the work I want to do, living with my partner. So I think you need to basically be aware of your, I would say, privileges, of course. But you also have to be aware of what, how do I put that? No, let's not put it. Basically, I just feel that we need to be aware of our lives. What are our priorities, and make sure that, like, those priorities you manage to fulfill and go ahead, per se. Yeah.
Yeah. It just mesmerized me, Sridhar, because this part of the journey, a lot of people don't know. We have conversations, you know, at home behind closed doors about this. And thank you for sharing this, because I don't think this generation today really understands what you have been through, what we have been through, because these are hidden conversations. Like you kept saying three times, I heard you say, well, let me not talk about it. Because even today, you don't want to talk about it, because if it surfaces, it is hurtful, right? Because it's quite dark. And why do you want to go into the darkness again? But, you know, coming back to your life, at that time, did you have close friends you could talk to? Did people understand from that point of view? How did your mother respond to the extended families once she got to know and once she accepted?
Yeah, so that's been interesting. As I said, like 1989, when I joined Bombay Dost, and I was living in Wakwala, which is in central Mumbai. And basically, my home became, because I was living alone, and there's hardly anybody at that point of time, young gay men living alone. So my home became a fulcrum for managing the Bombay Dost articles, you know. So everybody would come and gather at my home to do the pages, to discuss ideas, to even, I mean, that time we didn't have this digital thing. We would actually paste the thing on a paper and get it to take it to the press. So all the work started happening at my home, you know. And I had basically a roommate at that point of time called Niranjan Kamatkar. And Niranjan also is gay, but like we were just two gay men living together. We didn't have any sexual any sexual connection between each other. We're just two friends. And that was very rare at that time, you know. That was very rare that two gay men can, because at that point of time, meeting another gay man means having sex. I mean, that's the way it worked at that point of time, you know. But here was, we managed to put together a kind of a very wonderful family of at least 10, 12 people who'd gather at my home all the time. And we were not sexually interested in any of each other. That's beautiful, you know. So we formed an alternate family, which were great support. Even today, some of them are migrated to US, UK, and some of them are in Bombay, but far away. We're not in contact, but we still love each other. We are like a family even now, you know. So, and it was intergenerational family. So somebody was like 20 years older than me. Somebody was like 20 years younger than me. And that was a beautiful experience of having this whole family together. And we would have a wild time, believe me. Closed door, not the world knowing. We would have these drag parties at my home. We would actually have people, of course, having sex in the bedroom. And also like these wild parties where drag queens would dance with water on their head. And I mean, it's like you'll see in my film, Gulabi Aina, The Pink Mirror, some ideas about this particular lifestyle which we had. And also the thing is, like, at that point of time, we also helped each other a lot. If somebody was ill, we would actually go and take food to that person. Everything was still very, nobody spoke about this, that we're all gay men who had a family. We're just friends, of course, obviously. And somebody who had a problem with the family would come and stay with us for a month sometime, and we would help that person. So these were really interesting time. And but also at the time, it was a political awakening for all of us. We would share the thoughts. I mean, the internet was just starting off, and then we would get news which would carry in Bombay Dost. So we would know that, like, so much has happened in USA already, you know, USA and other places around the world. So much more work has happened in the gay rights movement, and we would dream of that, that someday we'll all be free, you know. So this set of family members was something which I introduced my mother when she came to my once to my home. And first of all, you can't have a party at home when my mother is there, when you're all drinking. That is anathema per se. You can't drink at home. But here I was, and unfortunately, my mother, that's what I feel sad. She has to go through this. So she basically cooked for all of us, and she was a witness to all of us drinking and talking and laughing. And but she really took to some of my friends. She really loved them. But she couldn't understand a lesbian couple who are there in the party. What are those two people like? Then I have to talk to her about being, what it means to be a lesbian. We had only talked about being a gay man, you know, till then, you know. So then I have to say that women also can be attracted to another woman. And that was an awakening for her. And so it was quite tough for her, but she took to my friends per se. And of course, later she took to Sagar like a water in the face. She just loved Sagar totally. He bonded with her so well, because like he's a wonderful person. He's so caring, so affectionate, and so beautiful. And he loves to take care of the home, cook food. And also, like, I would say he's so meticulous with all his work, whether it's kashish work or film work or homework. He would be so meticulous, and that's, I love my mother. So they would create recipes, and they would talk for endless hours. They would discuss books and films, and he's so caring, and that's just kind of really bonded. And that really, I think, made her more comfortable. Once she met Sagar and spent a couple of months with him, at my home. And only after my mother first came and met Sagar and stayed in my home for a month, then after I think like 6-7 months, my father came with my mother. He would, you know what I'm saying, is after the water is tested a bit, you know.
That's an acknowledgement, isn't it?
So my father came and stayed for a month and he was okay with the whole thing. Of course, even today, when somebody comes to my home, we would give them the bedroom and we would pretend to be not sexually engaged in any way. I mean, that's the way, we would not be intimate. That's the kind of social upbringing we have come in, you know. So if an elderly person is there in the room, myself and Sagar would never be intimate with each other, not even hold hand or hug each other. That's the way our upbringing is. So when my father and mother came, they got the bedroom and we would stay outside and we would be friends. I mean, we would, of course, they know that we are partners, we are lovers, but we would just be friends per se at that point of time. So my father also got used to the idea. So he was not like the father in the Evening Shadows film. He was not that. So he got used to my lifestyle and everything. But he always would say, what is there in Bombay for you? Why don't you come to my hometown, manage my, we have an electronic shop, you know. Because you're just not living anything, not making money, because I'm basically a freelance director and I don't make money, you know. So why are you living like this, paying so much of rent here, scrounging around? That's the way he felt. But I still feel that I wish I'd had a heart-to-heart chat with him before he passed away, saying that like that I'm gay and this is my partner and we are going to be together forever, etc. But that didn't happen. But my mother had a fantastic, still shares a fantastic relationship with my. The other thing which I really think was beautiful was when my Sagar went to my hometown a couple of times for my brother's marriage, etc. And then later also, my niece basically drew a drawing of a family, you know, okay, her idea of the family. And of course, her mother and father were there, and her grandmother and grandfather, and I was there, you know. And next to me was this unknown figure, which is Sagar, you know.
Oh.
So that was so beautifully. And she was just, 3 years old or 4 years old or something, that young, you know. She was just 4 years old. She made this crony drawings and she knew it, you know. I mean, she knew that like this, he's part of the family. And that really was beautiful. And though we have not spoken, even today, I've not spoken to my niece about my relationship. Of course, she accepts and she's friendly with Sagar, etc. But we never spoken about it, yeah.
You don't need to speak, right? You don't need words sometimes. It's just an understanding and that drawing says it all. So how did you meet Sagar? I know about your beautiful love story. How did you meet Sagar? And how have you managed to have this fairy life for 26 years? Congratulations again. Yeah.
Thank you. So basically, like as I said, like we were both cruising. I mean, he was returning from his home, from his work, late in the night, and I was cruising the streets in Bakola, you know. I was generally going towards a railway station to cruise, and found him on the other side of the road. And I was basically that day, I was kind of depressed because I had not found anybody, maybe. So I just walked across to him. He was not my type at all. He was this very cute, charming little boy. And at that time, my type was this burly men, big built burly men was my type those days, you know. And he was this cute little boy. Like I just crossed across and I said, do you have a match, you know, for my cigarette? And he said, I have a light, you know. And he gave me a lighter. And then I said, you want to have coffee? And he said, okay. I don't know what happened at that moment, but he came home to have coffee. We didn't have coffee, we had drinks, you know. And he at that time, my other friend, Niranjan, was also staying at my home. So we both staying together, you know. And Sagar fell in love with the home because it was artistically done. There were bamboo plant and Chinese lanterns. My friend was painting a T-shirt, you know, for his birthday, etc. So he realized that it was a very artistic house. And also when we spent the night together, we realized that we have so much in common in terms of art, you know. I discovered him as a poet. He narrated some of his poetry often without even looking at a paper. I said, wow, you remember your poems. That's a huge thing, you know. So then basically we talked about films, about writing, etc. And he was working in a hospitality industry at a hotel, you know. So his line was totally different. He was not connected to cinema at all. So something changed that day. And then I realized that like he was so caring because I don't know. It just happens at that point of time, you realize something. And then over, I would say, 2-3 months of knowing him, you know, before he moved in, I think 2 months later, he moved into my own, into the same house. He would be kind of, I would actually go and wait in the railway station for him to come after his work. He would work late shifts, and so he would come by the last local train, and I would wait in the station. Sometimes I would get down, or sometimes I would go, and that time there was no mobile phone still, you know, cell phones. So I would actually wait there till he came back, you know. So I'd go walk together to my home. And so a lot of friends call me Pakiza, because like I was waiting for the last train in the film Pakiza. Meena Kumari waits for the last train when her lover returns, you know, supposed to return, he never returns. But here my lover returned every night. So it was a beautiful relationship. And I think what made us hold on with each other was our love and care for each other. We just suddenly took to each other. Though, as I said, like I was not his type, he was not my type. But something connected internally, and these are basically something you can't verbalize or even ideate about what makes these connections, you know. So I don't want to believe that marriages are made in heaven, da da da, but like that's a fact. I mean, why these, we didn't have any social circles which connected us in any way. Okay, if you had not met each other, if I had walked 1 minute late in the street and he had come back 1 minute late, we would have never met. You know what I'm saying? It's serendipity completely. Totally. And that's really surprising. And that really held us on. And of course, it was a difficult battle for us, because we were here together, loving each other, and the entire family, the society, everybody wanted to be away. Nobody wanted us to be together. I mean, nobody wanted two gay men to be together, of course. So it was very tough. And but we built a home together. We managed to also, he basically quit his hospitality industry, joined filmmaking. We worked together under a director, Kalpana Rajmi, we assisted her. So we went on shoots together. That bonded us a lot more, you know, when we were working together and living together. Yeah, it's been a journey. I don't even know how to talk about it. 26 years is a long time. But I think there was some bit of a fracas in the first few years. But then it's been a smooth ride. Never been any misunderstanding. Anything we have a problem with, we sort it out before we sleep, as I say, you know. We talk it out, etc., you know. So we never go back to bed angry with each other, ever, ever, you know. Not in the last 26 years, no, 25 years, 1 year first maybe. I'll keep that. Maybe you were angry for some time. But the last 25 years, we've never been gone to bed angry with each other. And that's something I think, for me, I'm a more, I would say, tempestuous, adventurous, pushy person, you know. So I would give him all the credit for managing the relationship and maintaining, I'm keeping it balanced per se, because I keep traveling all the time, and he's more kind of rooted in the here, working here. And but I think his whole idea that, like, I mean, the care which he gives, and also I think I do care for him, I do give back the care, otherwise we wouldn't have lasted for so long, you know. But I think he's more responsible for our relationship sustaining for so long, for sure.
Excellent. I mean, such a beautiful love story, Sridhar. So you're together, you do things together, you work together. I mean, this is quite similar to what Nicola and I, you know, but in the LGBT community, long-term relationships, especially between two men, is just like questioned, right? They say that they think men, gay men especially, and I, please forgive me if I'm saying the wrong thing, but gay men are meant to be, supposed to be promiscuous, casual, you know, they cruise. Right. You know, these are things that we've heard about. I've personally not seen anything. But how do you manage this part of the accusation, let's say?
I think, like, I mean, gay men are definitely promiscuous. And I would say that, but if you like a person so much, you are rooted to that person, you care for that person. I would say that, like, beyond sex, I mean, I would say beyond sex, there's something called love, something called fidelity, something called trust, which binds you per se, you know. So the first few years, of course, we are sexually attracted. Now we are not as sexually attracted as we were. But I would say that, like, the love and faith and care which we share for each other binds us together. So I would say that, like, I mean, for anybody, I would say that, like, we didn't believe in a monogamous relationship right from the beginning. We didn't want that to be a strict box, okay? We didn't say that, okay, we didn't kind of pledge to each other that we're going to be monogamous, you know? But we have remained that, you know. But what I'm saying is, we have remained, I would say reasonably monogamous. I'm saying, let's put that right way, you know. Okay, so one has had one's alliances outside the relationship, but we have always come back to the relationship, you know. So I would say sexual fidelity is not primary in our relationship, but it's not like we are going around looking for sex all the time, you know. But if it happens and we talk about it, with each other and not have a threesome ever. So that's okay, you know. But basically, I think that's worked for us. Maybe it doesn't work for everybody else. But a lot of youngsters put a lot of pressure in monogamy. And this is the right thing. This is the right person. We need to make it work. Put so much of pressure that, like, it has to make it work, you know. I would say that, like, let it be open. I mean, I'm not saying open relationship, but I'm saying keep it open. Look at the possibilities, but it'll bring you together if you love each other. That's the way we have worked with. I would say non-exclusive fidelity kind of things. So that's the way it works. But as I said, we don't go around looking for any relationship or any kind of alliances. But if it happens, so be it. It's done and over with. And if I've had a relationship outside, I would say relationship, a one night stand outside this relationship, I would have made it clear to that person whom I'm sleeping with, saying that, like, I'm in a relationship. So there's no confusion. There's no possibilities of that thing going anywhere else, you know. I don't know what's the right way or not, but this is the first time I'm revealing all this. Like, I don't know whether you're going to edit it out or I'm going to ask you to edit it out. No, I won't ask you to edit it out.
No, because these are very important conversations and they're real conversations, Sridhar. You know, we should not be in denial. These things are real. There are different kinds of relationships. What you're sharing is a part of you. And also, there is no right or wrong. Whatever works for two people. But what you're saying is that you have to learn to communicate, as long as there's honesty, respect, love, and communication, right? That's what the essence of a relationship is. If it didn't work for you, then 26 years would have been not there, right? But, you know, we are coming to the end of our session very soon. I'm really enjoying talking to you. I just want to know, what would you say to this current generation? You know, you've done all the hard work, basically, for this generation. Now, the generation is really reaping the benefits of the hard work. It doesn't mean they are not facing challenges. It doesn't mean there are not difficulties ahead. But what would you say to a 20-year-old, let's say, coming out today?
I would say that, like, I mean, to a 20-year-old, I would say, I know I might be very controversial in saying that, but I would say focus on your personal, not just on the political of you, you know. Earlier, when I was growing up, we were focusing on the political more than the personal, no? Because that was the time when the challenges were there and we had to fight this whole system and bring about change, etc., the legal change and the social change. So right now, I would say, everything is too politicized right now by the youngsters, you know? There's too much of divisions right now, you know, within the LGBTQ community, outside the LGBTQ community. There's this left and right, and there's too many things happening right now. Anything you say, and also, so the social media is a great tool for talking about you and your work and your life, but it's also been abused so badly, you know, because everybody has a right to a point of view, and they just have to be blatantly just hammering that point of view. You're not even listening to others' point of view. You're not listening to reason. So I just feel the youngsters, I mean, I love them. I mean, I work with a wonderful team for my Kashish Film Festival and other things. But I just feel that they should be focusing more on their personal, not just the political. Political is important, but I think look into yourself. What is your basic need? You want to love a person, but don't love that person because that person is non-Brahminical, is a Dalit, and you're looking for those tags, you know, and then that person is not asexual, non-binary, whatever. You're just looking at these tags so much that sometimes you forget that this is who you truly love. You know what I'm saying? Is, I don't know whether it made sense in that sense, but, like, I'm just feeling that, like, we're also too many boxing each other and ticking too many boxes and making sure that all these tick boxes fulfill before you love anybody or fall into a relationship, and that really hampers. Like, me and Sagar, we never discussed. I mean, I think only after a year I asked him, do you want to get married to a woman? I mean, I didn't even ask for a year. We just together, we loved each other, and then after a year he said, no, of course not, we are together. I mean, let it grow, we just let it evolve, you know. I mean, that's the way we worked. And not just relationship, I would say even there's nothing wrong in, as I said, the right or the left, the right wing or the left wing, you know, they each have their own point of view. And you make your point of view, you can believe in one side of it, but you cannot be abusing and trolling and this whole canceling culture, you know. Yes. For me, that's a bit problem, you know. So the more aware you're becoming of the diversity of things, you're actually reducing the diversity by just being hammering on one thing. For me, that's a bit of a thing. So I would say for the younger persons, focus on yourself. Ensure that, like, who you are, your truthful self comes out, whether you're LGBTQIA+, be sure. And now there's, thankfully, there's so much support structure for you, you know, So if you're confused, speak to the persons. You can speak in social groups. You can speak to organizations. There's so many other avenues for you to reach out to. You know, everybody is there for you. And if you're looking for parental acceptance, I would say, just to bring out this whole thing, there's a Swikar, the Rainbow Parents group, which myself and Sagar helped facilitate founding as part of the Evening Shadows outreach work, you know. And Swikar Parents is so beautiful. They're a member of 120 people, and there are all walks of life across India, and they're ready to help. So you can just go to a Facebook page and ask for help, and they'll help you talk to your parents. So I would say that, like, I know that, and also, like, don't come out radically just as a coming out, like a holding a placard. I want to come out. I would say do it gently, because if you have taken so many years to come out to yourself, give the parents a little more time to take understand who you are, facilitate the understanding. Now there's so much more avenues for you to facilitate the understanding. Reach them out to organizations, reach them out to this Rainbow support group, whatever, you know. So I would say that, like, I mean, youngsters need to be, and I would say that focus more on your career. Focus more on your education. Complete that. Like, there's no rush to come out. Why is there this rush to come out when you're 13, 14? That's fine. But I don't understand that. You can be out to yourself, but you don't have to come out to everybody and fight. Why do you want to start your battle so early? Okay. We all have to fight our battles when you come out, you know. But why start it so early? That's what I mean. These are my thoughts. Maybe I'm totally wrong in what I'm saying. Is I'm a dinosaur. I'm 59 years old now, but I come from a generation which is older and seen something. My views may not be right or perfect for the younger generation, but just these are some of the things that, like, I would say, look into your personal, be confident of your personal, and then I would say come out and be open and talk about your issues. Yeah.
Sridhar, I agree with every bit you have said, because I've experienced this myself. And for us, we have the experience that we can give back. And that's why we started, Nicola and I started to say that we will bring these stories to you so you can have better role models. Because, you know, you and I didn't have role models. To date, I keep looking for a role model. Who else is there in the community who has been married, was meant to marry, got married, had children, left the husband because to live the truth? You know, so there are no role models, but I'm sure there are hundreds and thousands of women around. You know, but we don't find them. So that's why we started. And also these whole, I'm confused because I've been out only 1.5, 2 years. So I've been out in the community for a very short time. And I've come into this community with hundreds of people saying different things, pansexual, there's these different things, like LGBTQIAA, which gets extended, or these different pronouns that are given. And I'm not disrespecting anything or anyone, but I find it confusing myself. All these boxes we've created, sub boxes we've created, labels, sub-labels we've created. Our generation went through a fight, but we didn't complicate things. I think this generation is complicating things. And
I would, but I would agree with that. I understand that, like, they want to own their identity. I know that, like, their identities are genuine, and they that's what they want to own, and I respect that. But I'm saying being militant about your identity for me is a problem. You are saying that, like, rest all is not okay. This is the only identity you need to respect. We respect all identities. But you should also respect the gay men and the lesbian women as much as you respect the bisexual and the trans and the intersex and the asexual. That's my main thing. You cannot wipe away the gay men and the lesbian women totally from the planet. You know, we also exist. You know, that's my main thing. But I just feel that there's this beautiful change right now. I've been seeing some of the television programs where people who are asexual, people who are non-binary are getting roles as non-binary characters. I was just watching this for a series, Tales of a City, where this trans man, a non-binary trans man, basically plays a trans man. And I think there are avenues right now open for people to express themselves as themselves, be truthful. But I would say don't be militant about it. You know, as much as all of us are respectful to the diversity, you should also be respectful for the gay and lesbian community, which have existed and will continue to exist. I understand that, like, I mean, where the thing comes from. Unfortunately, the LGBTQ movement in India and most of the other countries has been led by by cis gay men, a lot of times, and by, I would say, educated, privileged cis gay men. That has to be corrected. I totally agree with that. You know, it has to be corrected, put into balance. So I'm very happy to hear voices by the other communities per se within the community. But I just feel that, like, it needs to be, I would say, conversational, not reactionary.
I agree. I totally agree with you. And what a fantastic conversation I've had with you, Sridhar. Thank you so much for giving us your time and such insights. And I know for sure that the audience will learn from this. And I hope that, you know, whether it's the parents of children who are out or people like us who want to be out, take longer time to accept, we hope you listen to this conversation, share feedback, share your thoughts. We'd love to hear from you. And Sridhar, I'm sure you'd love to hear from others as well. And
yeah, I mean, this is one of the most, I would say, most candid conversation I've ever had. I've never spoken about many of the things I spoke to you. You really peeled the audience, peeled the layers. Like, so, yeah, it's been a bit of a journey for myself. But I don't want to be considered as any role model. I've just lived my life truthfully the way I want to. And if you want to kind of feel anything from a part of my journey which resonates with you, I would say put a comment here saying that, like, yeah, I like that part of your journey. Or I would like you to be more, or some people might even say that, like, I like you to learn more from us, which is fine. I'm open to learning even today. I'm sure, you know, I'm learning every day and I hope to learn more about the world, about the LGBTQ community, about all of us. And I just hope that I've made a small contribution to this whole learning of us together. Thank you, Raga, for having me. Really appreciate
it. For your humbleness. I don't like to use this word normally, but I thank you for your humbleness. Amazing. What a beautiful journey you've had. Thank you for sharing. And thank you for letting me peel the onion layer by layer. That's important. Thank you. And thank you, audience, for joining us. Nicola, thank you very much for your support in the back end and for helping me curate this. And viewers, audience, anyone wants to share feedback, thoughts, as Sridhar said, please write to us at theviewsroom@gmail.com. Please remember to follow me on my Insta, Twitter, and Facebook at Totally Out Now. And remember, closets are for clothes, not to hide your truth. Signing out at Totally Out Now. We are watching today with Totally Out Now, presented by The Views Room. Thank you, Sri.
Thank you.